in these bars, only a big talk. Conversations on contemplate to my dark thoughts. Looking down on my soul now. Tell me I'm in control now. I can live long and I can live wrong and I can live right and I can sing song and I can unite with you that I love, you that I like. Look at my life and tell me I fight. Is that final destination? Is that false information? Is that false? Detonation, please don't bomb my nation. And bomb me, flew away. And I got my control, I'm here. You gon' hate me when I'm gone. Ain't no blood pumping, no fear. I got hope inside of my bones. This that life beyond your own life. This ain't physical for mankind. This that outer body experience. No coincidence, you been died. Bitch, you're dead.
In the lead, who you wanna be? I'm who they wanna be. B-E-A-U-T-Y-E. Never seen so much rage from a queen. Rage from a queen. Queen so strong, cause she was a machine. Girl of your dreams, Sinclair regime. Turn to the max, can't forget Maxine.
But fun to me as a goddess, I'm tired of being modest. 100 degrees the hottest, if we're being honest. Ebony antibiotics, black people win. They say we're being demonic. Angel in disguise, I hate I have to disguise it. Why you gotta despise it? Rich and demonic is why I'm making deposits. Carry all of ours, it's time to realize it.
Don't know, but take my power, my power, my power. Don't know, but take my power, my power, my power. They feel away, oh wow. They feel away, oh wow. Don't know, but take my power, my power, my power. Don't know, but take my power, my power, my power. They feel away, oh wow. They feel away, oh wow.
This that rhythm, this that lightning. This that burn, this ain't no perm. This that nappy, this that herb. This that kinfolk, this that skinfolk. This that war, this that blood. the front line, ready for war. Where you gonna run? Protect my grace, keep it locked in the safe. Don't make me get back to my ways. My power they never take.
Don't ever take my power.
Welcome, everyone. Hello. My name is Sierra Peters. Thank you for joining us. I'm the Communications Director at the Boston Dreamer Project. Before we get started, please note that our session is being recorded. All audience questions should be submitted through the Q&A function in the control bar, and the Q&A will begin after our presentations today. We are honored and grateful to be joined by Jacolby Satterwhite and Jonathan Lyndon Chase in a conversation we are calling Other Worlds. I want to acknowledge and thank my esteemed colleagues, Nia Evans and James Ramboy, for the coordination of tonight's event, as well as all of our partners who have joined us in creating We Be Known. The Boston Dreamer Project is a Black-led, democratic, member-run organization building a cooperative business, arts, and investment ecosystem in Boston with a mission to return wealth to working class communities of color. UDGEMA is bringing together neighbors, workers, business owners, investors, grassroots organizers, and culture makers to create a community-controlled economy in our city. This series of events that you're joining right now, We Be Known, is a collection of community planning and cultural events which honor the expertise and expressions of our community. In proposing a different economic system, the UDGEMA Project wants to respect that our communities have well-formed beliefs about our economy that are shaped and informed not only by what we may have been taught directly or transmitted through lived experiences, but also our interactions, the impacts, reactions, internal evaluations, what we move through, how we move, and what's around us, the lived experiences of our own making and others' making, our wider culture. Our buy-in and participation of, on varying levels, can be indications of what we believe is normal, what we think is possible. Understanding that we are engaging with our community's deeply and long-held beliefs, we want UDGEMA to be a compelling invitation, not didactic or dismissive. We understand that in order to be compelling, our invitation must be accepted, will be accepted if felt, and if our communities are moved. We must create the air that we are walking in, positively impacting and considering what is normal and possible, a cultural shift. We want to acknowledge and highlight artists and culture workers' unique needs and challenges as workers and entrepreneurs. Challenges that at their base, their work being regarded as magic or merely gifts in every sense of the word, rather than actual labor requiring compensation and support. We are working to refine the process for our participatory grant making allocation to local artists to be a process that truly honors artists and cultural workers as the economy builders they are. In creating other worlds, we were interested in creating a space of creativity and connectivity, a space for embodied and spiritual liberation, a space for transgression and interiority. We invited two artists whose practices allow us to dream and let us know that another world is truly possible. Without further ado, I would like to introduce Jonathan and Jacolby. So I'm gonna read their bios really quickly before we get started. Jonathan Lyndon Chase has lived and worked in Philadelphia their whole life, receiving their MFA from the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts, PAFA, in 2016. Drawing from their everyday experiences, Chase examines the relationship between space and gender as social constructs, the ways in which gender identity is affected by our immediate environment, and the dominant societal norms that exist within that space. Chase's practice is a hybrid one, ranging across painting, drawing, collage, and sculpture, and often all within the same work. Jonathan describes the subjects of their portraits as friends and family, or my own reflections, creating works that consider both the private and public nature of the body. Jacolby Satterwhite is celebrated for a conceptual practice addressing crucial themes of labor, consumption, carnality, and fantasy through immersive installation, virtual reality, and digital media. Satterwhite draws from an extensive set of references guided by queer theory, modernism, and video game language to challenge conventions of Western art through a personal and political lens. An equally significant influence is that of his late mother, Patricia Satterwhite, whose ethereal vocals and diagrams for visionary household products serve as both source material within a decidedly complex structure of memory and mythology. So today, we're gonna have the two artists give short presentations and then join together in conversation, followed by Q&A. After that, we're gonna have a DJ set by D Diggs. So let's get started.
Hi, everybody. I'm so excited to be here. I want to say thanks to Ajima Projects and to everybody who tuned in this evening to talk about stuff that's important to us. And just in the midst of a pandemic and the world being really crazy, it feels really good to be here and talk about some art. So I have lived and worked in Philadelphia my entire life. And what I have here is a PowerPoint of just some of the paintings and works that I've been doing since like grad school up until now to my current shows that are up. And we're gonna jump around a little bit and we're gonna connect the dots. So if we go to the first slide, you'll see that there's OUT8, Body and Space and Reality. So my work has a lot to do with everyday mundane experiences that are about Black queer bodies, our internal landscapes, mental, emotional, and spiritual. So I'm always constantly kind of thinking about how, in the ways that like collage is one of the influences for me, how all of like these things really do affect our bodies inside and outside, the way that we view and see ourselves, and how our bodies sort of change depending upon private and public space. So I'm always thinking about reality in different ways. If we go to the next slide, you'll see this is like installation. So I work across many like different mediums, primarily painting. I really love painting and drawing a lot. They're my first love, and it's branched into ideas about installation, sculpture, and video, and all of these things, and collage as well. I'm kind of coming together because I see space and our body space as being really, really complicated and always kind of liminal and in flux and ever moving and changing. So this was my freeze booth, and you'll see like there's paintings that are kind of sticking out of the wall. The floor is one's kind of like a green carpet, like grass, and there's like these rocks balancing like this painting. So this room in particular talks about the public and private lives and experiences. Going to a supermarket and going out to this public space, a liminal space that's a market or a poppy store. We call them here in Philly corner stores, and getting food. And these figures here are kind of just leisurely carrying on with their day, going in and outside of their private space, which is a safe place, the place where you can demask and kind of be yourself, and then the public space where people kind of like interact with your gender in like a different way. Like belief like gender is like really like fluid and like really expansive, and definitely not just sort of stuck in like the binary, which leaves you really no options to exist as a complicated human. If we go to the next slide, these are close-ups. A person about buying some meat at a store. So this one's like a drawing. It's like a watercolor pen on paper. And then the image next to it, this person is buying like cabbage. And I draw a lot of references just from like photographs and things that I take, poems or thoughts that kind of just come to me. And I kind of put them all together and like have like these binders. I think y'all can see it. So like they kind of works and shows kind of come together as an archival kind of system where I'm kind of putting together like just different ideas and things that just kind of stick out and are important to me in different ways. So it's a way to kind of like balance my intuitive kind of like energy and tendencies with something also like kind of structured so I can communicate my ideas to the public and to like my audiences, friends and families and stuff like that. If you go into the next slide, this is another shot. So this one is, thank you. This one is inside of like a kitchen. So there's like broken plates and you can kind of see how it's a salon style kind of installation. So I'm always kind of thinking about ways that paintings can be more interesting in their relationship to the wall. Just like historically paintings flat, you know, 2D medium, they have like a long, rich marriage with the wall. So I'm always thinking of ways to kind of complexify like that genealogy. So if you go to the next one, this again is like this person in a public space and they're kind of sometime more than one person or they're one person kind of shifting temporally due time. So these kind of like movements with like the lines and the marking and a line weight for me talk about just like passage of time and sensitivity to like the body, soft bodies, and thinking of how masculinity and its relationship to softness and gender performance. Moving to the next slide, a lot of my work has to do with like transit, movement, time, as I was sort of mentioning. So if we go to the next one, this was from my Rubel's residency in Florida. So I was commissioned to make four really, really big paintings. And these are the biggest paintings I ever made. And this one is of a couple that I saw just kind of whizzing down North Philly, that's where I'm from. I've been north, south, east, west, all over Philly. And I just kind of take pictures, talk to people, see what they're up to. And this one is from a photograph, which I work from a lot, photo references. And this is just like, for me, important to talk about like Black bodies, like male bodies, queer bodies, being relaxed and being the center of our own narrative. and not so much necessarily thinking about sort of like the sort of political tensions and expectations that are always kind of like aiming to police our bodies and our narratives. So again, this is very much about like being the center of your narrative and like just being in like a loving, tender, relaxed space. If we go to the next image, this was an older one. So this one is a person carrying like what looks like heads. So they're kind of like heads, but then they're like masks. So when I think a lot about identity and how we're made up of different kinds of people moving and shifting the different roles we take on, this person is kind of leaving like this abstracted space and going into like this other kind of open, kind of mysterious space. So I really like playing with and thinking about the tensions between two things like soft, hard, smooth, sharp, night, day, these kind of like things that we're always kind of navigating towards. And very often we'll have to like switch mask for whatever the situation suits us. So if we go to the next one, this one is 2017. And I really think it's important, like, it's really exciting now working with so many creative people, brilliant minds, and honoring like our ancestors in the way like people who've been working and talking about like queer, Black, gay life. And this one is more of like a romantic scene. And if you see kind of like the bodies again are mixing into each other. So there's eroticism and sex, which is really important to talk about. It's a part of our lived experience. But then there's also these moments of just like tenderness and thinking about what touch could look like in a romantic sense, a platonic sense, all kinds of ways. So if you go to the next one. Someone like help me with time because I'm going to keep laughing. This one is from my 2016 show, Quiet Storm. And that show was centered around the radio time slot, WDAS. And it would play like this like really great kind of collage and like mix of music, like R&B, some jazz, like really kind of like low tempo, like relaxation, kind of like sensual kind of music. And for me, thinking about the complexity of like the Quiet Storm radio format makes me think of the weather. So kind of double entendres in a way, or multiple meanings kind of happening. Because I think that when you're talking about time in the body, there's moments where like you can slow down or rest, but everything is always kind of moving on some kind of micro or macro level, like big and small. So these people are in Philadelphia and they're crossing the street. There's like signifiers of like lipstick, music. I like to try to talk about each of the five senses, smell, taste, touch, all of those as ways that kind of like reflect and ping pong off of our body, stick onto our body, and are around the space. Moving to the next one, beauty ritual, mask, and performance. So I think like when you're talking about the relationships, the differences between private and public, very much so, even in a way that we communicate to other people, a lot of it has to do with our proximity to danger and comfortability. Living in like a world that, like the internet, and we're always bombarded with just like so much information, so many graphic, violent images. For me, there are parts of my work that do kind of talk about like pain, sadness, or struggle, but then also joy, thriving, and self-celebration. So this one is kind of me and my husband, and I'm doing his hair. And if you notice, there's like a collage kind of element down at the lower left. And this one is painted on muslin. So my paintings, I'll paint like on cotton or canvas, bed sheets, sometimes clothes. So the actual surface and the material kind of becomes like the material really like pushes forward like the space that they're in. So if you go into the next slide, this one's more recent. And I like to play with like objects similar to the one that we looked at before with L8, like these objects that are kind of spilling out of and holding up the painting's reality and kind of coming into like our reality as like the viewers interacting with the painting. So clothes for me are like really curious and just like really fun to think about, and this absurdity that clothes have like a gender. And so this person is inside of an interior of a bedroom and they're just trying on different shoes. If we go to the next one, this one is more about a different kind of time. Thinking of like ways that the body can be talked about just with like certain portions of it being shown and then the rest of it kind of melding in or becoming one with the background. Hair is like so like important to just like daily ritual, just like a mundane ritual, brushing your hair, combing your hair. For me, it's like a really tender and like loving act to think about self-care with yourself and for like a lover or significant other. If we go to the next one, this is a drawing, just like charcoal and paper. It's like a sketch. So sometimes like my drawings kind of stay, I kind of have to fill it out. Like if I'm like, okay, like, this is heading towards something that feels right. And then sometime the drawing kind of like matures into maybe like a painting or something. So thinking about the archive and collecting all of that information and data, it's always something I can go back into to kind of reflect on the interior of my practice. If we can move to the next one. So the person in the drawing previously was doing push-ups. So I do a lot of paintings of like people kind of like in isolation sometime, just kind of working out, contemplating themselves. Many times the figures are together with people, and a lot of times they're just kind of by themselves. So this one is just a person exercising and just the sort of temporal movement of their body moving in like the space. And the next one, let's see, another interior, this person's like taking off a shirt and the body in this one is like singular. So there's just like lots of movements that are happening currently, time that has passed or is like kind of happening at the same time. And if we go to the next one, I do lots of like bathroom kind of interiors. Like I have like a few bathtub paintings with people kind of like reclining, thinking of like classical postures and things of that nature, and kind of a moment of like rest and reflection. Water along with like the weather doubles as metaphors for me with just like our relationships as like Black people with water, liquid, fluid, movement, body, space, I think is like very much an interesting element, a property that speaks to me about the interiority of like our minds and bodies and emotions and the spaces that we travel through. If you go to the next one. another drawing. So this one is also kind of like a preparation. But because I consider myself pretty prolific, I always just kind of keep like a nice momentum of like doing like drawings or sculpture or different things and kind of always experimenting and kind of running towards things that I don't know, uncertainties in my practice to kind of see what'll happen. I think we might have a few more left, but if we go to the next one, I get often asked a lot about like the sexual energy in my work. And for me, it has a lot to do with thinking about like just the battlefield of like the Black male body and in different like zones where we're always kind of policed in this way. And for my experience, it is important for me to talk about like bottoming. Like and so in so many spaces, like the artist I automatically think of, like Mapplethorpe, photographer, white photographer, dealing black and white photos, and they're problematic for me in different ways, just with the relationship with how they're approaching and perpetuating like these like stereotypes of objectification with our bodies. And in the community, you know, there's like a lot of work to be done internally, just thinking about how we view femininity and softness and what are these things that maybe we have been brainwashed into thinking, and kind of really trying to like look at ourselves and decolonize our notions of how we think about a femme body, submissiveness, what does that mean? Roses enter my work a lot as kind of a reflection of like lips, pleasure points, nipples, buttholes. It's really important to talk about every facet of our body. And bodily makes people feel uncomfortable, but being uncomfortable, I think it's okay. Like something's happening. Can we go to the next one, please? AM PM Lock is the title for this one. So this one's about the color kind of like telling you that there's like a shift in time and space. And sometimes paintings are done very fast and sometimes they're very slow. Which is great because having sort of like a rotation of things just to constantly work on, I'm always constantly learning from things that are happening maybe in a group of paintings or in one painting. So this one is kind of an example for like a faster one, like a fast kiss, a fast tussle, embrace with someone. If we can go to the next one, please. Domestic items I really love a lot. I consider myself a homebody. So this one is like a more of a mixed media. It's like foam acrylic on this like kind of a poly cotton kind of material. And I like to use like numbers as symbols for like sound and thinking about just like numbers as like something that crosses our paths a lot, like with all of the information that we're always kind of constantly digesting. And if we can go to the next one. Yeah. So music, weather, and emotions that we described, thinking about like masculinity and like maleness and what that has looked like, what it looks like now and what it could look like in the future. And I'm really like pro talking about mental health. And I think it's really important thinking of our interiority that we talk about it a lot more and be okay with being uncomfortable talking about it. That way a lot of people can start developing conversations around, you know, like these things that are not so good for our inner selves and for our communities. This is the installation shot for Quiet Storm. And as you can see, like there's different rhythms and patterns of how like the paintings are moving. We built kind of a room inside of the gallery space's room, which was really fun. So this one, the weather being a metaphor for emotions, which we cannot control, but only can prepare for. So like how it's snowing, we can't control snow, but we can prepare and kind of wait through the moment like we would like a very intense emotion and kind of trying to get back to these nuances within ourselves. If we go to the next one, this painting is titled Quiet Storm. So I have a love for music, jazz, hip hop, rap, really love like 90s, early 2000s stuff. So this one is referencing love, tenderness, a thunderstorm, a mix of emotions. So the composition has the heads kind of in the window. It's dark. The bodies are kind of becoming one, iconic, like kind of like fashion brands that are just like a part of my everyday, like FUBU shirts and stuff like that. It's like timestamps. The domestic pots, which are collecting water, rainwater or leaking bodies. So this one is like one of my favorite paintings. If you can go to the next slide, please. This is the interior of the room that we built in the gallery. So these paintings are of just people that I just saw kind of walking around in my neighborhood in Alani, where I was living at the time. So the room that we built inside is the nighttime outside public space. So they're performing their gender in a way that best suits the way they want to adorn themselves and how they feel beautiful and how they want to navigate the outside world. While the previous slide is more of like the inside of the space. So again, kind of playing with those like kind of opposites and flipping them in and kind of confusing them. If we go to the next one, Yeah, compound spaces. If we can go to the next slide, please. I grew up Baptist, and so for me, like a sort of church setting, I think when we're talking about mental health and all of these sort of things, I think there are spaces like this that are really complicated in ways where they're family spaces, they're safe spaces, but at the same time, there's also lots of violence happening, being told you're abomination, you're going to hell. Your way of existing is not good or evil. And that's as I was describing, some of like the more tense or heavy emotive parts of my work that I explore. If we go to the next one, another singular figure, a person in the dark, self-contemplation, as much as it's about our relationship to our space and other people, just thinking about like the human condition and what it singularly feels like to exist as like one person or multiple people at the same time in different ways. If you go to the next slide, these are people on a bedsheet, three halos, three crosses. This one again is thinking about just like being raised Baptist and like my sort of trajectory of religion and coming into now recently African spiritualism and sharing and extending out like an honest and vulnerable kind of conversation about what it's like to exist in that complicated crossroads of things. Just gonna check my time for a second. Okay. And the next one, crying. So this one is just about sadness and how it's okay to be sad and our relationships to what we deem as like strength and what we're allowing ourselves for the outside world to see. So the body is sort of more taking up the space. It's a little bit more crunched, as you can see. And I'm a big crybaby. I still cry. I cry all the time. So this one is a lot about just like that particular emotion. If you go to the next one, I promise there's only a few more. This one's about grieving. There are so many people who have been lost in just like all of the chaos that's been happening for the last like few months, few years, really. So this one is a group of people just kind of wishing that the person who is the focal point of the painting, the one who's in the middle, you'll kind of see kind of like there's like a beam directing from his head. thank you. kind of like a beam kind of radiating from like their head in this way. So the transparencies talk about delicacy and the temporal rifts that our corporal bodies go through, our tangible bodies. And the people who are just kind of like ghostly kind of sitting around leisurely, just grieving this person who is no longer present. If we go to the next one. Okay, so this is from my solo show last year titled Windrider. My grandma, who was a cowgirl, she migrated up from the South to Philly when she was 16. She passed away in 2018. So I have been developing this work for quite some time, addressing like my own genealogy through her side of the family and our love of cowboys. She lived North Philly near like Temple, Cecil B. Morris, Susquehanna Dolphin. And this is kind of a portrait of a memory of her home and experiences that I had just kind of being in Philly and then seeing Black cowboys in the Fletcher the first time, like Strawberry Mansion of Fletcher Riding Club, which is local here. They do like great stuff. So it's kind of like a love letter to her and to people who share like those kind of like ancestral kind of like backgrounds. If you go to the next one, still the same show, Windrider, about cowboys, love, grief, things like that. Barbecues, another compounded kind of weird tense space where again you're in this private but public setting with friends, family, some you maybe haven't seen in a while, maybe the shady auntie who's there, right, who's like asking you all these questions about your sexuality. You know, like there's memes and relatability that we joke about these things, but they're very real and raw emotions that people still think about and grapple with today in many ways. So collectively for me, the sight of like the stoop barbecue is something that a lot of people relate to in different ways. The grill is kind of setting in as like fire, hell flames and stuff like that. It's okay. We can go on next one. Thank you. fast forward to my show that's up right now, titled Big Wash. It's centered on like a laundromat. It's like the liminal space and always kind of like looking at these rituals of like cleansing and purification with our body. So again, the motif and the element of water is in play. And for this particular painting, this person is setting a dinner table. It's mostly acrylic and marker on a sheet. And so you'll see like this sort of like patterns that are coming in and out. So just like layers and back and forth of scraping and pulling to get the image that kind of come to be. So this person is wearing boxers that were a silk screen made for the residency at their fabric workshop that's in Philadelphia. So this person is just like waiting for their company to arrive because like home is like so important and home structure is really important, both as a physical place and as the home, like in our hearts, right? If we go to the next one, which I think might be the last, this person is a single figure. They're in a sort of an abstracted space, but I'm thinking of them kind of transversing through point A to point somewhere. You'll see like the sort of pattern purse that they have. So similar to like the underwear that was in the last painting, this person has like their purse that is made from a silkscreen print that I developed, and they have a vibrating phone in their purse. And this one for me talks about proximity to danger and self, self-building, right, in different ways, where for me my closet is full of all kinds of clothes, right, but I know that because of the way I perform my gender in certain spaces, I have a more higher inclination to encounter danger of some kind. So this one is about the beauty and the celebration of this person, and then also kind of like where are they and where are they going. And I think that's my last slide, so yeah, thanks for listening. I know I said like a whole bunch of stuff, but I can't wait to like answer questions and stuff. Thank you.
Hello, can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Oh, so it's my turn. All right. Okay, so this is the first time I'm actually sharing my screen for a talk. I usually like give the slides to a person, so let's see if I can do this. So hi guys, I'd like to, wait, host disabled participant screen sharing.
You should be able to screen share now.
Okay, I can screen share. Okay, can you guys see it?
Yep.
All right. So I like to begin most of my talk with the Matriarch's Rhapsody. This is a 43-minute codex of basically how I kind of started my kind of conceptual lexicon for the past 10 years, which I'm moving out of this year, actually. And so what you're looking at on the left are drawings made by my mother, Patricia Satterwhite. Like from my childhood, she made them between like my age of 3 and till when she died, which was 2016. She would, she had this sort of delusion of grandeur, kind of schizophrenia, she was diagnosed with schizophrenia, and it kind of made her have this delusion of grandeur, kind of feeling that she was a Da Vincian inventor, and she would send her ideas to lots of companies like IBM and the Home Shopping Network, and all, you know, with extreme conviction. And they would sometimes send like nice letters back or whatever, but I believed in it as a kid, and I kind of started drawing with her in order to learn how to become an artist because I was so inspired. She told me I had to learn how to draw and able to use her crayons and stuff. And so basically, like, fast forwarding to college, I started painting. I went to college for painting, high school, college, and grad school for painting. But I had like a dead end with it politically because all of my teachers were like white and trying and not understand. And it was a very kind of sparse, I think my teachers were very market driven and they were thinking about what's happening in contemporary art and seeing a sort of sparse atmosphere for painting. And so therefore they were pigeonholing me to do things that were very limiting. And I felt like I needed to remove painting from my lexicon in order for me to have some agency with my conceptual terrain. So as you know, I started to think about what's personal to me. And I thought about my mother's drawings, and I thought about fluxus and Dada, like the Dada and the fluxus movement in the 30s and 40s and I guess some 50s. Those movements were about surrealist practices that were, they were rejecting painting and rejecting propaganda and war. And it was about making art that is about nonsense. And then the surrealists and the Dada and the Fluxus, they would play games of chance with like text or so, like they would like write automatic writing or exquisite corpse-like games with text, and you would perform in response to the text. And I thought like, okay, so I want to like make my private archive sort of like, I want to make my private archive sort of like that practice. So I took a lot of my mother's drawings from South Carolina to New York City and Baltimore and Philadelphia. And I basically, through trial and error, going to Skowhegan and doing performances and figuring out like through experimentation that I could trace her drawings in an architectural program called Maya, an animation program actually, that Pixar uses and architects use. I traced her drawings, piped the lines, added some planes to them, and I made 3D animated sculptures that could be composited into these worlds, and I could have my cake and eat it too as a conceptual painter that makes 3D animation virtual reality films that are spatial using my language as, you know, in a space. So, oh no, screen sharing has stopped. So we're gonna move on to Country Ball. I'm trying to get the screen to share. Here we go. Can you guys see it?
Yep, you're good.
Okay. So Country Ball is a piece. It was like, okay, this home video, I was obsessed with it because not only was my family in a time where we were stable and it was before the crack epidemic weren't really having and divided the Black family, sort of like a utopia. And it was a Mother's Day cookout. And I was thinking about, at the time I was researching Gelede masquerade culture and African Nigerian mother, like they worship the Queen Mother through dance rituals in a circle, and they play these songs. And this was a Mother's Day cookout in the woods. It's like flash of the spirit parallel that I was obsessed with. But then I was also obsessed with like the fact that you can see parts of my queerness as a child. I'm the little green boy right there. And I want to imitate the girls constantly. You can see my first, like my queer attraction, like my female identification. So I was like, wow, this is so layered. But then I thought about how like this video also contains all the recreational material culture objects that my mother drew in her drawings, like Mercedes-Benz cars and KFC buckets and chairs and plates. And I was like, oh my God, this is the architecture for me to create an animation. And I can reperform this in the way that Marina Abramovich reperforms her personal mythologies, or, you know, how the performance is acquired by a museum. This is my thing I can control. So Well, how do I share the screen? Share the screen. Can you guys see it?
Yes.
So basically I used the audio from, also the weird thing about the audio is that my brothers bought these gay house tracks from New York City to South Carolina, and everyone was dancing to like acid house that's associated with like bathroom sex. It's really crazy. But in this video that you're watching, I sewed 30 costumes that mimic the attire. I used my mother's drawings that were recreational material culture objects like KFC buckets and carousels and slides and all that stuff. And then we're gonna move forward. Basically, the practice spans long. We have a limited time, and I don't know how much time I have left. Actually, how much time do I have left? Nia?
I think you have like 10 minutes. You have a good amount of time.
Okay, so I wanted to premiere a new video, look, surprisingly. I don't know how many people are in logged in? How many people are logged in?
We got 40 people in the chat and then people on YouTube.
Mm-hmm. 40 people?
Yeah. And Jacolby, okay, before you share, can you make sure you click optimize for video clip? I think it's
how do you do that?
After you share, you should be able to, at the bottom, it should say share sound and then optimize for video clip. It's the second one. I don't know if you see
Under
basic.
Thank you so much for this. Okay. Yeah. Let me know if it plays smoothly.
And
so
share computer sound.
Oh, share computer sound?
You should see, they should be side by side. One says share computer sound and then one says optimize for video play. Okay.
All right, let me start over. Sorry, guys. I'm like,
world premiere. Listen, don't be sorry. We all here.
We're just
this is a world premiere, Jacolby.
Yeah, actually, yes. To be honest, I was gonna do it at the Studio Museum, Open Studios. I was gonna do an excerpt, but I feel like there's like 40 people here, so I'm gonna give you a little world premiere. Share computer sound. So how do I get back on Zoom? Okay, Zoom, share.
Yep, optimize for video and share sound.
Wait. It's not showing up. Share. Okay, we go. Optimize, share sound, okay? Can you hear it?
I'm gonna diss you right now. Thank you. Thank you. Oh,
the video. Let me turn my volume up. Hold on, I can't hear anyone. Oh, shoot.
We're muted.
Hello?
Can you hear us?
Yeah.
We are silently all saying, wow, 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 screaming, yo, so dope. Thank you, Jacolby.
Yes, thank you.
Chat is blowing up.
Oh, you're muted, Jacolby.
Oh, I was saying thank you because it's going to, I'm super excited to hear that you guys like it because it's going to go on a tour at the Gwangju Biennial and Athens Biennial and the Hauser Kunst, and I'm doing something special for it with the City Museum with the installation. Along with, they're going to, I'm just going to show what we are in hell when we hurt each other, this film I made at Mitchell and Ash, but I'm glad to share it with you all. And Jonathan, you are so amazing. It hurts. It hurts.
It hurts. Oh, that's so sweet. Thank you. Like, you're like fucking amazing. I just was like, so much information. It was like so rich. And like, you have my husband dancing over here. It's really.
Yeah. That's so good to hear. Tell your husband to come over. Say hi.
Come say hi. Oh, don't be shy. Just stick your head. That's
fine. Okay, fine. Well, hi. Hi. All right. Hi, Jonathan.
Hi, Jacolby.
Apparently, we're supposed to have a conversation, but I actually am ready because I love your paintings. So I've always loved your paintings when I saw them because I'm sorry to jump in so aggressively or whatever, but I like saw them and I was like, you know, I just like, you know, I mean, I started out in painting and doing different kinds of painting, abstract. I had a New Rausch phase, I had so many different phases, but I felt your hand and spirit and your investigation and like the intent. And I felt like there are some things that the canon doesn't allow in certain periods of time and other queer men want to express it in. It was like a queer synchronicity of Black people of color, especially Black men. And for a certain vernacular, have a vision with like their vernacular and painting. And I was like, oh, yes, there it is. And it is prominent. And I was like, oh my God, like candy, a kid in a candy store. So.
Thank you so much. Like, I remember when we were talking about like a few weeks ago for this talk tonight, how my first introduction to your work was at the ICA in Philadelphia. And just so you know, like how important your work is like to me at that point, I think I was in undergrad and I was still kind of working mostly like in like embroidery and kind of soft stuff and just kind of trying to figure out my own vocabulary. And then as I walk into the ICA and I just see like your video installation, and I think you were also there with a bunch of other queer artists, like Calip Lindsay, I think too. But for me, it was like this huge moment to see, actually for the first time ever, my first Black queer artist in like an institution. And it was just like really, just like so influential and impactful to me to see someone who looked like me, lived a very similar like navigation of life, be in like such a great space in conversation with other people. And then upon like researching you and everything, I have like a great relationship with my mom, and even more currently with the passing of my grandma, and how just like on my intimate level dealing with like the grief and like learning from her and these sort of things in a different way definitely resonates with me, with you and like your mother with the source material. I think it's really beautiful. Yeah.
Thank you. I mean, yeah, like I have like so many questions. Like, and as in regards to painting, like I always think of like, I don't know, you kind of give me like this weird hybrid of like Francis Bacon meets Cecily Brown meets of like, it's just meeting a lot of things, but like many histories and many different strategies for like negotiating your conscious with the space that you're building. And I'm just curious, like, who are your inspirations as painters?
Yeah, definitely Francis Bacon. I love Francis Bacon. Just like his like the way he deals with like emotion and space and like a rawness that I think he's unapologetic in some ways. I really love like Jacob Lawrence, Henry Taylor, Wengeshi Mutu.
Oh, I love Wengeshi.
Yes. Like I see like elements of like her language, like that's an environment of your work, like this how so like I love how you do like natural and like kind of cybernetic at the same time. It's like really like this delicious garden of like earthly delights, like Bosch.
Yeah.
It's like another one of my favorites as well.
I have a big Bosch book. I have like a giant in my living room. I sometimes look at it while I'm smoking weed.
This is a perfect thing to look at. Like, they're so wild.
Yeah, truly.
Who are some other people that, like, you look at? I definitely I look at you and other contemporaries, like Jordan Castell, John Edmonds, Tiana McLaughlin, who, like, archive stuff. Who's in, like, your mind, like, your heart's
who's best? On my mind?
Yeah.
Well, I am kind of, like... I've been thinking a lot about Chris O'Feely, and
yes,
I've loved Chris O'Feely. Like he was, you know, someone who just like really—I don't know—there's something about it. It just has guts and spirit, and that's really influential. And I don't know if it shows up, but he's definitely an influence. I can admit now that it's like, you know, Matthew Barney's mythology strategies or in Joseph Beuys and Bruce Nauman and like so many people, to be honest, like so many painters, like I used to like Neil Rauch and Georg Baselitz and like Mama Anderson and
Mama Anderson, yes.
I'm all over the place. I'm like the United Nations with my taste. It's like, I like a little bit of everything. Because everything can like inform your own strategy, to be honest.
Absolutely. As I was like just watching like your work now, like one thing that really fascinates me, just about the medium like you work in like video is I wonder if you would mind like just talking about a little bit, just like your ideas about like time. Like, I think that they have similarities with, like, painting and, like, light and everything, but, like, the just, like, video motion, like, yeah.
Well, so I start my time, all of my videos start with me spending 2 months making these static images that are still, like, stills, and they have to be resolved as paintings. So I make these tableaus that can be, like, my C-prints that are shown at galleries and stuff, and they're, like, they're costly to print or whatever, but like I make like 10 of those as a storyboard. It has to have like a Pier della Francesco or Rubenite like kind of like compositional resolve in order for me to go on with it for the narrative purpose. Mm-hmm. And so I'll make like 10 of those, and then I'll do like an automatic writing practice to kind of like think about how these images can move and weave together. And I kind of put together like language from my mother's drawings, the language from what I'm thinking about politically and personally, privately and publicly. And I kind of just like bridge the air through nonsensical writing. And then I think about in animation software. Yeah, it's sort of like, you know how painting is scraping away, adding, smudging things around? The crescendo of building these narratives isn't traditional in the way that, someone writes a linear story. I'm feeling for what my soul is feeling. Like, I'm feeling for my soul. So I have to, like, have a weird way of reperforming that way of mark making, but digitally. And so I add and remove, build narratives, build automatic write, think about, like, the way an image is juxtaposed next to another image. And I'm sort of building a harmonious visual narrative as a sculpture. Mm-hmm. And that's why I think that they do something different than the traditional moving image film. So, yeah.
Yeah. Wow. Oh, that's
so cool.
Oh, wow.
I'm like, oh, cool. I had to think of a question. Okay. So, my question, I have so many questions for you. I mean, how do you decide? Actually, this is like, how do you decide what material? Sometimes you weave between fabric and oil on canvas, and is it acrylic? Well, do you use oil?
Yeah, I used to only use oil for a time, and then I just like started trying to complicate things for myself. So like I just kind of use like all kinds of stuff. Yeah, like oil, watercolor, chalk pastel, oil pastel, stuff like that. Has a lot to do with like specifically, I guess, like what's happening in an individual painting. So for instance, if I'm like painting like a bathroom scene, I might lean towards more like acrylic because there's like more kind of synthetic plasticky things kind of in there. Or I'm thinking about like slippage and things like that. And I use like lots of water when I paint. So for each like fabric, like cotton or muslin, or if it's like a rug or something, I'm always like interested in the play with just like how the paint gives it like that tension, like that push and that pull. So if I'm wanting to kind of do something that's like softer or more translucent in a sense, I might not gesso like the surface. I'll just let it kind of bleed in because I might be thinking of like stain as memory and stuff like that. And then it's like a matter of just like kind of pushing and pulling, moving around,
yeah,
and layering, lots of layering.
Well, I love that you kind of make the materiality in your paintings develop meta narratives. Like you're thinking about, oh, something feels impermeable and disappearing and disintegrating. I don't gesso the canvas and I'll apply this absorb. Actually, that, you know, I actually think about that kind of thing. One time I was in an undergrad, I made this painting from like poppy board, some like gay porn site. I used to do these nasty ass paintings, like insanely. I used to try to like develop them like in a Rubenite kind of texture with them in any kind of like application. Mm-hmm. And anyway, so I was broke as fuck and I bought like linen. And linen was a big deal to buy because it's so expensive on a roll. And yeah. I stretched this fucking linen and I was like, I'm gonna use rabbit skin glue like a real painter person. And I didn't gesso it properly. And I was like Mike Tyson boxing with this canvas for a month. So the image would just appear, but it kept coming forward and then going back into space and disappearing. And actually it's kind of beautiful, that process of fighting this image for intimacy between these guys, and with a little cat on the floor. And I had to beat the shit out of the canvas for it to like sing. And it took like 2 months. It was like unnecessary labor for what it happened. But that reminded me of what you said. I was like, there is a metaphor in that process.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I love how you're describing like your physical relationship with like the material, like the surface, like beating it up. It often, sometimes it feels like a ring. Like you have to like for me, like certain surfaces, I can just be rougher on, like just like throw it on a floor or something, or just like use like I use different things that aren't traditionally brushes, like brooms or scraps of cardboard, just different things to get different ways like to pull the paint.
Yeah. I mean it's always important to, I mean, that's how I think about 3D animation, to be honest. And I'm a backdoor 3D animator. I taught myself in graduate school. And like, I've been teaching myself ever since then. You never stop teaching yourself. But I never went, I wasn't properly educated in painting. I was probably, you know, in 3D animation, it was in sculpture and painting. And so like, what I'm trying to say is that the way I think about 3D animation, that's why like my body is so hard-edged and composited in a certain way. Because for me, I am thinking about the materiality of all the properties in the digital media to make something that is like not about an illusion of space or a, is more about how this is like raw material actually make interesting things. Like, you know, I think it's like, if I choose to have a live action scene clashing with a 3D scene, it's usually to reaffirm a certain tension that I'm building up in the narrative or whatever. But like, I get it. Mm-hmm. And it's funny, like, I don't know. Yeah, I think about all the like, I keep, because in 3D animation, you use light, you use the 3D modeling, use the, what is another variable that you're always like thinking about? Like the way the camera lens is. Mm-hmm. And all these things can be like coordinated together. And the color, mm-hmm. the reflectivity, the specular, that also you can do like depth of field, and you can make the, you can make the light, you could do things that are like Edward Hopper versus, you know, whatever. So the point I'm trying to say is that, like, I think about them as characters, these properties as characters. And that's kind of like why I think I'm able to like have a freedom within the visual harmony in the narrative. Mm-hmm, sorry, I don't know what I'm talking about. Hello? I think we're frozen. Hello?
Yeah, it seems like Jonathan froze. Okay, I think Jonathan's back.
Hello?
I'm back, hello.
Hi, sorry about that.
Oh yeah, I didn't know, like, did we all freeze?
My bad. What was I saying? Oh, I have two questions. I'm gonna break them into two separate ones. I like that you mentioned character, because I'm curious if, like, do you feel like you take on a character or like a different identity or multiple at the same time when like you're actually like performing and dancing? Because that like blew my fucking mind, that like how you just take these two mediums together.
Oh, like I'm dancing and stuff.
Yeah, like
actually the older I get, I'm like shocked at how deep, like I think I get, so I am like a method actor kind of thing. Like if I have a project, I become the character that makes the project. I think like making Birds in Paradise, I became a raving queer international psycho demon, like dancing druggy queen. I don't know, like, and then I like made the series and I said, oh, calm down, whatever, I did it. because I believe like you gotta lean into the work, you know? And
yeah,
work is my life, it's 24/7. And I feel like it's, I definitely, you know how like some people like I guess some like actors don't bathe for a week if they have to get into a role. I unfortunately do that instinctively, and I didn't realize that. I don't have borderline personality disorder, but I didn't, or maybe I do. I didn't get that checked out actually, but maybe the art practice is like the condom to getting my borderline personality disorder assessment, because I go through these phases where I have a big idea and I become the idea entirely. And when the idea is done, I move on and become the person that makes another idea. So it's sort of a reinvention. And like right now, I'm more of a solitary, like slower thinker. And like, I think I want things, ecstatic things for a minute and make them move slower. And I don't know, I'm just like really interior. Before it was like chaos and destruction and like the breaking down paradigms and breaking down systems of like what I should be like. It was about disruption. It was about like completely resolving a visual art experience in a disruptive manner, something that the canon doesn't allow to be sophisticated. And so I was very like punk and anti, and then I calmed down. I'm punk still in certain ways, but it always, like, you know, it goes with my age. I definitely do have a psychotic, weird method acting way of making art.
I just think that's like so fascinating. as a person living with bipolar disorder, and for me in undergrad, that being like a really pivotal moment for me, like reflection wise and stuff. I really love like some of the sensations I get like when encountering your work, that there's like these like things that are opposite bumping next to each other, not so much, but just like all like kind of like manic energy happening, but then it's like the tempo or rhythm is like kind of like really like relaxing and smooth at times, just the way that the bodies are sometimes looking more aggressive, or maybe like they're more just like kind of liberated in like their movement. Just like really makes me think about like in some ways the interiority of my experience living with a person who has bipolar not even a disorder, it's just like a different way people interact with like life, right? I don't necessarily see it as a disorder.
Oh, I have the same thing. I live with someone, well, I shouldn't say that a lot, but like, yeah, I do. And my mother was bipolar, and she, when her 40s, it became full schizophrenia. But I grew up with that. From the day I was born, the bipolar part and I knew what that was. And that then when schizophrenia came, I dealt with a whole different demon that was like, and I don't want to call it a demon because that's like, but when I say demon, I mean like schizophrenia is a little more chaotic. And it's more, it's like bipolar on speed. I take Wellbutrin. Monitor my own stability, and I think that's helped a lot. Being an artist and being isolated and working on screens, it's definitely takes a toll on your mental health and your perception of space. And like, right. You really can like, you know, the we're artists, we're negotiating these variables as our, we make money off of negotiating these weird abstract nonsensical variables. And so we built like, we're marrying a lexicon that is completely logical, which seems like the avenue to take you down some kind of mental illness, you know, because the pressure of being a successful artist, or like if you have to like work on a, that pipeline alone can also be an agent and a trigger to poor mental health, in which I have had. So that's why I appreciate all your Instagram posts and stuff about it, because mental health, like even, you know, like my mother's schizophrenic and made 10,000 drawings from 6 a.m. morning to noon. And that's what my work has been about. And also I've dated so many people with bipolar and it's fucked me up. Nothing's wrong with that. What I mean is like, it's fucked me up in a good way. It's been really challenging, but it taught me about patience and silence and not reacting and, you know, just a stoic kind of position towards humanity. But I love everything you post about. All your posts are really like, I need them when I see them. I'm like, oh, that's cool.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. Thank
I
you.
Needed that. Good. Yeah.
Because I don't want to forget it, right? Avatar space, cyberspace, virtual reality. One thing that automatically made me a fan of yours and what you do is your connection with video games. And that makes me also think of like the sort of fantasy elements that I kind of feel when encountering your work, and also science fiction. So I'm wondering, like, do you have like faves that you go to? Like for me, I love Samuel Delaney.
That's cool. At the moment, no, but when I was a kid, it was all about Final Fantasy series on PlayStation and like role-playing game. Well, I beat Final Fantasy 7 like 5 times. I got Knights of the Round, like I got the really hard shit, like all the characters maxed out levels. But Sweet Golden and Chrono Trigger, I like to play all the RPGs, Zelda, Ocarina of Time. Like I was really into like the deep games, like Metal Gear Solid and stuff. And Shenmue a little bit, but it was too high concept for me. And Resident Evil and Tomb Raider was really, really fun. But the books that I read the Tolkien series when I was in seventh grade, and that was really inspirational. And then as I got older, I loved Game of Thrones until they went past season 5. But I still like think that I actually love Game of Thrones, to be honest. And even with that bad season 8, because life turned out like season 8 after season 8, if you watch the show. But I also like pop stars. I love Madison Square Garden concerts, like Madonna's Drowned World Tour and Confessions on the Dance Floor Tour. Like those staging productions are so inspirational to me. Like that's my science fiction. It's like crazy ass 50-year-old women pop stars with too much money on stage with the power of technic coming out of a bull's asshole.
Oh my god.
Like the audacity.
Yeah. Like I never would have that. I'm just like still like in awe of this, like hearing you like talk about this. So this is like all like very, very cool. All of the games that you mentioned, like I'm still fans of, and thinking about body space relationship, for me it's like a curious thing to just find ways to think about that type of cyber avatar space, like just even like the fact that we're both older than like Google, just seeing how like art in the space now is like really gotten like so much more complicated and expansive, and how like popular culture and like the art world in this way are intersecting just with video game culture and technology and stuff. Mm-hmm. It's all like very exciting.
I know, I'm making a video game.
Are you? Fuck. Okay, I'm sorry.
But I am. Yeah, I am. It's okay. So it's this. Well, I got a grant to do it, and I'm doing like too much. But I'm making a video game. This year's the primer for it. I'm designing it, and I don't know how involved it'll be. I know it's like my idea is ambitious, but we'll see. I don't want to talk too much about it. But I'm making one for the front triennial in 2022. So
yeah,
done. And I think like the first part will show as a public art piece at the Cleveland Clinic outside the Biodepository Center. And it's a really weird conceptual game. It's on layered on top of layers. So, but I don't play video games anymore, which is crazy. Cause I have to make the 3D animations all day. So I have no room. Well, now that I've gotten a certain understanding of my language, 3D animation, it leaves me more room. And I like paint downstairs and stuff. And I'll teach myself, you know, like, but I don't play video games anymore. So I'm only basing I'm making a conceptual video game. I don't want to make a video game because I love video games. I do love video games, but I don't have time to play them. And when I do make a video game, it's going to reference the period that I did play them. If you know what I mean.
Absolutely. Like, we have a whole lot more, like, we could talk for hours and hours.
I'm like, sure,
yeah. Trying to make one too. So I'm like, yeah, we need to like just like talk like a lot. Yeah.
Yes, definitely.
Yeah. That sounds really exciting. That's dope.
Oh wait, what?
No, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Oh, I had nothing to say. You say are you going to questions to the
No, thank you both so much for this beautiful conversation. This has just been amazing to witness. And thank you all for joining us, everybody in the chat that's been blowing it up with your questions, comments, and reflections, everyone on YouTube. We have a ton of really awesome questions. If you didn't get a chance to add your question, please add it now as we go into the Q&A section. So the first question that I'm going to choose is from Claudia. Claudia says, for both Jonathan and Jacolby, both of you manifest such potent, raw, robust, and deeply personal archival manifestations of like raw essence of emotion. It's channeling and challenging the archive. And so she asks, from both of your layered perspectives, how do you envision your work existing in the archive? What energies do you trust the archive to uplift? And I would add, how does your work interact with the archive?
Can you ask the three questions again? Sorry.
How do you envision your work existing in the archive? What energies do you trust the archive to uplift? And my question, which is, how does your work interact with the archive? Because you both talked about personal archives, so that question.
Okay. I mean, my work is, my work is the body and the archive is the cellular system. It's the DNA of the work. So like, you can't constellate it. If it's constellating, the archive is a constellation of things that metastasize into this actual form called the work. What's the second question?
Yep. So then do you trust the archive to, or what energies do you trust your archive to uplift or an archive to uplift?
Whatever they're asking to do. I mean, my archive is about not knowing what I'm going to get and curating how like 100 things here, 100, how do 100 drawings, 100 performers, 100 soundscapes from Ableton Live, 100 images from YouTube, 100 images from my family photographs, and how do I pick like a common thread between, how do I build a Venn diagram between these different kind of spaces to come together and make one train of thought? Like, it's more about how do I like build a harmonious system with these incongruent materials. And so that's how that's what I wanted to uplift the energy that is asking to. So what's the next question? What's the next one? And then I'm
I think that you just answered it. The question was how does the archive interact with your work? Or how does, yeah, like where does the archive fit into your work, the personal archive?
Oh well, I just answered that.
That's what I'm saying. You was already on.
All right, we have another question, and this is for you, Jacolby. This is from Denzel. They say, I'm obsessed with the many moving parts that each scene has and how all those moving parts contribute to creating a universe within the scenes. What was the ethos of each scene, and how do you feel each scene juxtaposed against each other came together to create this video?
Oh, well, spending 2 years in, well, not 2 years, one, it felt like 2 years. After making Birds in Paradise series, I was threading across a lot of, like, I was walking on a tightrope with certain politics. And then when the pandemic began and then George Floyd, and it was just a crisis after crisis and panic after panic, and my back being, I had these major existential crises while under pressure to make so much work with little resources and sometimes little money sometimes. It's just like, oh my God. So like for the first time I felt, I normally don't work from a didactic kind of lecturing kind of like political space that's really, really on the surface. But this year was so on the surface, I was like, I can only thing I can do is make a simulacra of chaos and of a simulacra of the body, the interior and the exterior, the psychological abuse of the physical abuse of our goal. And that video kind of like makes this unusual triangulation between like our sadomasochistic relationships with living, which you see in the little rave scene in the beginning with the black men, and they have these biological viruses inside of them when my body is an antibody gliding back and forth, and then it transitions into these stacked TVs of like Tetris, like the media looks like Candy Crush or Tetris, and it's like a hybrid of like me in a fantasy space with torches lighting the American dream and Ku Klux Klan lighting the American dream, and then my mother's drawings about the color purple are masked over the images of them. Like, it's sort of like, how do I take these charged spaces to dance with each other in unusual ways? And you kind of see it throughout. You see that chaos. I mean, you see it. And then it ends beautifully at the end. It's like, yeah. You know, there's so much I could say. I don't want to take up. I could talk about too much. And I don't want to.
No, that's beautiful. I love your answers to everything. So I'm like fangirling over here. Jonathan, I want to give you an opportunity to answer the questions about how the archive and how you integrate the archive in your work and how you see the work, your work existing in an archive.
Thank you. I think that's a great question. Thanks to the person asking. I think in some ways for me, like the work is the archive. Specifically for me, when I say that, what I mean is like I'll have a show that's responding to personal events that happened in the 2000s or the 90s and stuff like that. So I'm trying to kind of like put all of like these more collective experiences and emotions that we kind of like bond over so that they can have a place where people can just find them, like, you know, younger people, people who just don't know about maybe certain things, just seeing like my work in relationship with the archive as being like a step or a branch, a part of like something bigger, right? Like this genealogy that's already been going on for some time and ever growing and expanding. And on a personal level for me, like my like energy, mood fluctuations and waves, like I go through like seasons, right? So for me, it's a great way that like I paint from like emotion and feeling and intuitiveness and reaction and stuff like that. And I always have like just so much kind of circulating that it provides for me a space to, in some ways, practice a way of entering self-care into my practice, so that I'm not like kind of tiring myself out or just kind of like being this really overwhelmed, right? There has to be like this balance of like structure, keeping a system of things, keeping a record of things. And so in that like personal way, it works for me that way too.
Thank you. And so this question is for both of you. What writers, what are writers, theorists, and poets that you both like to read? How does the textual slash theoretical bear upon the visual for y'all?
I like to read art books a lot. Like I like to read monographs, like books now, you know, Georg Baselitz or like, I like to read monographs a lot, and I like to read poetry sometimes. Sorry, I'm drawing a blank. I take inspiration from so many places, like with literature. But it's mostly actually art theory seems to kind of, I don't know, it's kind of weird to say that. Because I think about space so much, and I'm really interested in like matter of fact things. So it's either like philosophy or it's just things like phenomenology stuff by like Sarah Altman. I don't know. I like philosophy and art theory and monographs.
Mia says you're an art encyclopedia in the chat. I want to direct the question also to you, Jonathan.
I'm a huge like nerd, so I read lots of science fiction and fantasy. I'm really into Samuel Delany right now, which like this makes me think of like Afrofuturism and like just like the wave of like you're seeing like Black characters and stories being told in a space that we've been for so long told that, oh, we want to be historically accurate and we don't exist in these spaces, you know? So for me, I feel like it's like a radical and liberal, liberating kind of like field. Like I think like science fiction is like so necessary for like so many things, like to envision ourselves in spaces. I love Maya Angelou, Audre Lorde, Toni Morrison, Joseph Beam, people like that, Essex. Recent, like Danette Smith is a great poet. And I'm also reading, oh my gosh, a book called 100 Boyfriends that just came out. And just like the mundane, like intimate stories that this person is telling me through like this book is just like really great. I read like lots of theory too, but I kind of just read like a mix of things, but I really love poetry. Finished like a Langston Hughes book recently, which was like hard, but hard in like a good way.
That's amazing.
Hot.
I guess this is a question for both of you. How does self-care shape your artwork? Jonathan, maybe you could start.
So for me, like self-care, like showing relaxed bodies and people doing sort of like, at times you could say like nothing. Like I think naps are hella important. So often like I'll have people sleeping or just sitting. It's just really important to like think of our bodies outside of like what capitalism tells us to do and all of these expectations and stuff. So that makes me think of time and how pause or slowness kind of comes in. Being a person who like fluctuates drastically between speed and like slowness. I pay kind of special attention to that, and where like painting for me is like the lines are kind of blurred, like kind of similar to what you mentioned earlier, Jacolby. It's like an impulse just to kind of do like making things. Like if I go a while without making something, I'll feel sick. So for me, it's like a meditative way to connect with myself, and again like through other people. So it's like a cleanser, a balancer, a safe space for me to just be like messy as fuck and just like do like whatever. And yeah, hoping that in ways people seeing like images depicted of like Black queer people, and that
Jonathan, you just froze. Okay, they'll come back. Sorry, Jacolby, do you want to answer the question? Oh, you're back.
Oh, I'm back?
Yeah.
Sorry. Okay. Oh my gosh. So, what was I saying?
You were talking about posing.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much. Like, yeah, it's just really important to like see like these poses and images as something that has like a big platform as many people can see, so that I'm not necessarily seeking to give like a definite answer for something, but just to help expand and open up just like broader ways of just like thinking, like in this case, what self-care can look like. Yeah, like definitely like productivity doesn't define us, and it's hard, but it's really rewarding, I think, in the pursuit of self-care. Like it'll just like build upon yourself more.
Sweet. So we're gonna do one more question.
Well, Jacolby, do you want to answer it as well?
What's the question again?
How does self-care inform your work?
Oh, Jesus Christ. I mean, I try my best, and actually I'm really big on that. I like have so many regimens before I can get to work, and I have to keep a certain ritual and system because I'm so on demand in regards to like what I have to accomplish, that like in order for it not to be suicidal, like I'll like wake up and I'll exercise for 2 hours or hour and a half. And I buy these like really expensive gel vitamins called nano vitamins from like the lipospheric vitamins. They're like, you know how you get a B12 shot and it's like $200? Well, these are like come in packets and they're disgusting. You put the gel in your water and you like gulp it down and they come vitamin B. Basically you get like 100% of the vitamin instead of like 10% of the vitamin that you get from taking a visit with the pill because of the food dollar. Because these vitamins go into your cell. So like, I think about, like I do that. I drink lots of water and like, I don't know. I kind of like just build a really weird pared down minimalist system of take. I had to gaga or Oreos, and I just really had a bad week because I ate like 2 boxes. But self-care, how does it fit into my work? Doing self-care. And I think like also mentally, you know, I try to say that my work is not sentimental and is really objective, how I deal with my mother's archives. Because really when I deal with it, there's no emotional relationship, but dealing with it does help me make peace with that really hardcore emotional relationship. Because outside of like me making the work, you would think, oh, it's a tribute to her. I could hate her. What if I hate her? I could hate her. Sometimes I hate her. I hate her in my memory. I'm like, fuck off. And I'm making this work about this bitch I hate. But this one, I'm like, oh my God, I love her. But the point is I'm interrogating something that could have made me become a criminal or a crazy person if I wasn't an artist, because of the traumas that I endured dealing with a scenario that was probably just gave me all kind of pathologies, you know? But like the act of making art is almost like, you know, an automatic therapy, because I was every day I'm circulating and making sense out of reifying this really tragic situation in my life and making it into something beautiful. Yeah, that's it. Order.
Sweet. James, do you want to ask the last question? Okay. So the last question. Boom. Sorry, just 1 second. Jacolby, do you record or mix your own tracks? If so, can you speak about the process? Mel says, side note, I enjoyed the live performance of Love Will Find a Way a while back at Pioneer Works. Thank you.
Oh, thank you, Cedric. So yes, my San Francisco MoMA commissioned my first album with my band Pat. I pair it with Nick Weiss from Teen Girl Fantasy. He's one of my best friends now, but like I split half of my budget. I had a big budget and I split half of them. We spent two years together. In the studio, he taught me all about Ableton Live and Pro Tools. And so I basically like really understood how to create the soundscape that matched the visual landscape I was going for. But after a while, like when I would record with him from 1 p.m. to 9 p.m. at night and then go home to my computer and animate, you know, because acapellas come from my mother. She recorded 155 acapellas on cassette tape in mental hospital and at home. And I took all her acapella songs that she wrote and I made it into a concept album. I picked like 11 of the best songs and I curated a narrative around it. And then I made these trip hop and electronic music and acid house referencing soundscapes that come from like the gay club in the early 90s with Black queer men and I kind of, and Tricky and Bjork. And I thought about all the things that inspired me with like, you know, the certain London scene. Like I really had a like a music history thing combined to like develop the soundscape. And me and Nick did what we could to make it happen. And simultaneously, and sometimes the video would inform how I was going to go back to the sound studio and make things. Because I knew this video was going to be very mechanical with motorcycles and highways. And I needed something preserved. I needed something like, you know, like that's how we were talking in the studio. Like I'm making something that kind of gives me this vibe. And we need to find a synthesizer that has this exact sound, and then we put it on top of it. You know, it was like the sound became a material and a sculpture, and I love it. I can't wait. I think I'm starting on an EP this year for my Cleveland project, but yeah, I love making the music. It's a major, yeah. So the album was printed at Pioneer Works, and they have the, you know, like the track list. The whole, the album is a sculpture. And you know, the Smithsonian, Herschel and Smithsonian bought the album. They bought Birds in Paradise and the album came with it. And it, so the Herschel is the first acquisition of an album by the Herschel Horn, which is really cool. So that's cute. Good for Patricia. Yeah.
Very cute. Very cute. Congratulations. Thank you both. Thank you both so much. We really enjoyed having you here. Y'all, don't leave yet. Stay tuned because Ms. D Diggs is going to give us a live set, but please, you know, send your claps, your snaps, whatever else you need in the chat before we say goodbye, or not goodbye, but you know, we're gonna keep dancing. But thank you both so much for spending your time here with us.
Thank you. This was so great. Jonathan, I'm going to text you afterwards. I'm like, oh my God.
Thank you, everybody.
Wow, this is so great. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Ms. D. Diggs, is you ready? We're going to take a pedagogical pause.
I should be ready. Hold on.
Yeah.
Let me switch all my things to the right frequency.
Thank you, Denzel, for joining us.
Yeah, that was amazing. That like really was amazing. Shout outs to both of the artists. Let's see. This. I feel good. Let me know if you can hear me. Like I knew that I would know. Okay, nice. All right, everyone, my name is Steve Diggs. I'm gonna play some house, some soul, some disco, a lot of different things. Ooh.
want, but I don't know. Everybody keeps asking me why, but I don't know. I come to clap my hands, I come to stamp my feet, I come to lift my voice.
what? Put your drink down, baby, you done had enough. On the dance floor, get it going, stretch this up. I got sweat so sweet, you can taste my touch. Hands on my hips, you can feel the thrust. I'ma turn around, get it down, shake my butt. Haters over there, you be paid those dust. We gon' dance all night, yeah, yeah, what?
from each other? When are black people gonna learn we gotta stop stealing from each other? When are black people gonna learn we gotta stop stealing from each other? When are black people gonna learn we gotta stop stealing from each other? When are black people gonna learn we gotta stop stealing from each other? When are black people gonna learn we gotta stop stealing from each other?
Yeah. everything. It's how it ought to be. Day breaks, so free. I am better every moment. You are close to me. Come on and get down. Come on and get down. Come on and get down.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for hanging in there. This is going to be my last one. Thank you for having me. So many friends in the chat. It's been really fun.
My brothers and sisters, the time has finally come for us to come together and live as one. Stop the violence, stop the hatred, stop the pain, and give our children a chance to live in love again. Find one common thread, one common ground, and come together in unity and peace will soon be found. Love one another and know it's the only way, and you'll have the strength you need.
Shout out Ejima, shout out Sierra, shout out Jonathan, shout out Jacolby. Thank you, Nia, everyone. Seems like a good time for some shout outs. Enjoy, everybody.
Of the world today, I can't help but get down on my knees and pray that we will take a stand for love. To solve the problems that divide the world of black and white, to end the racism, you know we've got to fight, so we must take a stand. The violence, stop the hatred, stop the pain, and give our children a chance to live in love again. Find one common thread, one common ground, and come together in unity and peace will soon be found. Love one another and know it's the only way, and you'll have the strength you need to take that stand today. Yeah.
Thank you, everybody. That's me, D Diggs.